Richard Hadlock. The program is The Annals of Jazz. This is a program of August 3rd, 2008, and I'm observing a 49th anniversary because it was on August 3rd, 1959 that I launched The Annals of Jazz on K-Jazz. And it's been a long, long time, and yet it's still exciting to do, fun to do, and I hope you feel the same. It's when I went to think about that first show, I remember feeling rather determined to begin with Louis Armstrong. And one reason was that other than the Verve records that Louis might have made at that time, Pat Henry was not very interested in music of the 20s, and I don't think Louis doing West End blues was even in the K-Jazz library in 1959. I thought it was important for me to kind of represent that kind of music on a station that was primarily concerned with modern jazz, big bands, bebop, whatever. Okay, and I kind of feel that way still, so I want to open this program with that same record that I started with 49 years ago. And I'll have more to say about Louis Armstrong, but let's listen to West End Blues first. One of the truly great recordings in the annals of jazz, West End Blues. Well, everyone knows that now, but, you know, 49 and 50 years ago, You mentioned Louis playing West End blues, and people say, what? That's a pretty old record, isn't it? Yeah, it certainly is. I think, matter of fact, Louis himself would be 107 tomorrow, August 4th. But back in 1959, we all thought July 4th was his birthday. That's what he said. But scholars have proved that it was August 4th. So this broadcast is also a kind of celebration of Louis because it's on the eve of his birthday. And I thought it would be fun to share with you an old interview I taped in 1962. I've never put it on the air. I've always just kind of squirreled it away and thought someday I ought to put this in print. But I think even better, I'd like to share it with you on this occasion. This is an interview at the Fairmont Hotel, and I should mention a couple things. First of all, the room was not air-conditioned. Believe it or not, they had the window open for air, and that meant we heard street noise, clanging of cable cars, all kinds of San Francisco sounds in the background. And secondly, there's a kind of quaint little regional accent glitch in the middle of the first part of this. I mentioned to Louis that maybe some Europeans, there might be a lack of something in jazz that they, when they went to play. And he heard the word lack as being like, because in New Orleans, that's what it would be. So be aware of that when we come to it. Otherwise, we had a good time, and as we went along, it got looser and really more intimate in a way. Armstrong was a delight to talk with, and just a straightforward, warm-hearted man. Okay, let's go.
I'm sitting up here in the Fairmont Hotel with Louis Armstrong, and this is a special privilege for us to be able to talk with Louis tonight. Good evening, Louis.
What'd you say to him? How you doing?
Fine.
Oh, that's nice.
Been packing them in as usual, I see.
Yeah, having a lot of fun and doing a good job.
Mm-hmm.
Folks all appreciate, you know, a lot of the fans come around. And, I mean, people that's been following us for years, they come pay respect, and we have one grand time.
I might ask you, incidentally, talking about your current engagement, about your new musicians, because you've had two or three additions to the group since you were here last time.
That's right. Well, you know, no organization stays the same
sure.
through the years. We originated the group. We all got together in 1947 when we opened up in Billy Boyg's. Well, a couple of the players that was in that band, and some of them had their own band. And then, you know, they go other places. See, there's Big Sid, he's dead, you know.
Yeah.
So you have to put in a new man that's in the same category and have the same feeling and same mind of the music we play, you see.
Mm-hmm.
So that it turns out all right.
When you're talking about the same feeling, one of the things I wanted to ask you tonight was, in talking with men who came from New Orleans, I get the feeling that there was such a thing as a New Orleans style and a New Orleans feeling in music that was kind of special about the people who came from that town. Does that strike you that way, or?
Well, maybe when I was a kid, but as the musicians spread it out all over the world, and the youngsters came up with the listening matters and the essence of what they heard through their schooling days and coming up on the instrument, and it made it turn out all right.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way that is. You know, a whole lot of youngsters playing Dixieland music just like the old Trojans.
Yeah.
That's the way that is.
Can you tell when you hear somebody from New Orleans that he's from there?
Not necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
Not nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
Bugsy Spaniard plays good Dixieland music. He's from Chicago.
Yeah.
But I mean, they all migrated from New Orleans. And,
yeah.
And he's sitting on the bandstand right under Joe Oliver and instills something in him. And with his mind of Dixieland and the original Dixieland band and, mm-hmm. and the modern music and all of it, he takes some and leaves some, and then he play what he feel he should play, and that's the way I feel. I mean, you don't have to just take after everybody.
Did Joe Oliver keep a pretty tight discipline on his band, or were you free to play
no,
pretty much?
No, played as long as you was in there.
Yeah.
And everybody played what they thought they should play, like Johnny Dodds and Kid Ory and the boys, and they all got together and they played the way they thought that music should be played. Mm-hmm. And the only way they knew how to play it,
mm-hmm.
that was the way to play it in those days. And it don't sound bad now, you know, when a bunch of fellas like there ain't but a few left.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't but a few left. You can round them up in your hand.
Well, is this an art that some of the Europeans have learned all the way, or do they still lack something of the feeling of the old New Orleans?
They lack anything you play in Europe, especially that good old jazz and the way you play it, and there's a whole lot of them playing the same thing. And like mm-hmm. I said, was instilled in them
mm-hmm.
from the days of Bechet when he first went to Paris.
Yeah.
Stayed around so long. And a lot of the good old timers, Glover Compton, and I can call you lots of musicians, not hundreds of them, but lots of them that went in the early days.
Mm-hmm.
And the kids grew up under that.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't change it.
Well, Ed Hall told me not long ago.
And Ed Hall is another one.
He mentioned to me that he thought he could tell when a clarinet player especially, but even a trumpet player, came from New Orleans. He said there was something there that he could tell.
Well, in a way. But there ain't that many coming from New Orleans nowadays.
But it's been so long now.
Been so long.
Yeah.
There ain't that many coming out. One or two every now and then, you mm-hmm. know.
I wanted to ask you if you could clear up a couple of details in your own history that have seemed to be a little foggy over the years. One of them was a venture that you and Earl and Zooty had at Warwick Hall. Remember that, or Usonia?
Yeah, that's right.
Do you remember who was in that group besides you and Zooty and Earl?
Well, I don't think it was the three of us.
It was more than a trio. Wasn't it a hot six?
Well, that's what we was doing. We rented the Warwick Hall and they looked around the Savoy Ballroom, opened up right around on the corner, right around on 47 and South Parkway, with peacocks all over the front of it, flittering, and they took all the people.
A lot of money put into that one.
Yeah, and then we have to close the hall down, and so we just went on the west side and gave dances on Sunday nights.
Mm-hmm.
And a little too rough over there for us, cats shooting all in the place. Yeah, it was three of us at the time. We was, if we say, hustling.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it didn't last too long because we didn't have no money.
Yeah.
But if it was anybody else, I can't remember to tell you, because it was just mm-hmm. the three of us was, you know, we was so popular around Chicago at the time, we thought we could make it.
Yeah.
But it didn't mean a thing after the Savoy opened.
Yeah, they had it.
So we had to say, like, if you can't beat them, you join them. So we all went into Cal Dickinson's band.
Uh-huh.
And we had to do it right away. Yeah. And from then on, we stayed with Cal.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, when you made some records with Earl, you know, like West End Blues and Fireworks and all those, you remember?
Yeah, I remember those tunes.
That was the time you and Earl were working with Carol, wasn't it?
Carol Diggers?
Yeah. Now, did some of those tunes you recorded with a small group, were they also being used with the big band?
Well, some of the bands, some of the tunes we pick out different fellas, you know, like that. Will, mm-hmm. You know, Lil was in the Hot Fives before Earl, you know, and then mm-hmm. and Earl come in, and we put Earl in Lil's place. And then finally we turned it, when Don Redmond started bringing arrangements from Detroit, like Hear Me Talking to You and mm-hmm. things like that. Yeah. Well, we made it Hot 7.
Yeah.
But every time we recorded, we had different amount of groups.
What I was trying to get at was if this was the same kind of music that you were presenting to the audiences.
Well, we didn't had no special kind of music at that time. We just tried to play it good mm-hmm. of that occasion, and probably came out a little different because the instrumentation.
Yeah.
But we all had that same swing in mind.
Mm-hmm.
That's all. We didn't try to prove nothing.
Yeah.
No. Just turned out good because the fella, like we played behind Lillian Del Christian that time with mm-hmm. Jimmy Noon, Earl, and myself. That's the way we felt. Was it a dream? You know, we felt symphonic at that time in our Dixieland way, one of them things.
You remember a record you made with Carol called Symphonic Raps?
Symphonic Raps,
yeah.
I couldn't play it now if you asked
me. That's some pretty tricky harmony.
At the time, you know, they wasn't bothering about putting bands together. It's too bad somebody didn't sign us up. At that time,
yeah.
We could have had a lot to offer.
Why was it that Carol never made any records much? Maybe one or two?
Well, because there wasn't nothing to do. The booking agents was asleep.
Yeah.
At that time.
Because, gee, it was drawing big crowds.
We come through now with something like that, and it would be a different story with Joe Glazer around. And,
yeah.
But we played for Joe Glazer at the Sunset with the big band for years, you know. And he's the only one that picked up on it.
Mm-hmm.
We couldn't get into William Morris and them people. They wouldn't be bothered.
Yeah.
Because Oliver, who was with MCA for a long time, but they didn't do nothing with him.
And he never did get to New York until it was too
late. Well, too late, yeah. It's a pathetic thing, you know. They abuse jazz all the way. They're just now trying to appreciate it after everybody's gone.
Yeah, and they're still abusing in some places,
well,
too.
Well, yeah. I just don't pay attention to it. I'm to the point now where email, if they get to the point where they don't appreciate my music. I mean, I had a good time for 49 years, and I'm still happily married, and I just sooner get a little band and teach them up and, you know, do something like that. I mean, I'm not going to fight it.
Well, I don't think you have to worry
You're
about
You're listening
that.
To an interview with Louis Armstrong, which I conducted in, I think it was in January of 1962, San Francisco. You could even hear the clanging of the cable car bells in the background. And as I said before, this is a totally charming man just to sit down and talk to. He's quite a delight for me. I thought it would be a good break right here to play for you one of the records that Louis mentioned, or session, I guess it was, that he mentioned, with Don Redman added. This one is actually an Alex Hill number called Boku Jack, and it makes for very interesting listening because of Don adding his alto and probably tweaking the Alex Hill arrangement just a bit for this small group. And also that Earl Hines is there, as he was on West End Blues, and Fred Robinson and Jimmy Strong, I think, are also there. So it starts to sound like a bigger group than the old Hot Five. They also have Dave Wilborn coming over instead of Johnny St. Cyr playing banjo, and he was with Don Redman in the McKinney's Cotton Pickers. So that adds something, and Zooty was there on drums. When they did Boku Jack, Louis just ate it up as if he had been waiting for this piece to come along, and plays with extraordinary freedom, more than he did when he had his New Orleans friends and the Hot Five, I think. Okay, we're going to hear this 1928 recording, and then we'll go right into the second part of the interview.
Taking on any students or tried to show anybody?
Don't have the time now. Mm-hmm. But if I see a cat that's promising and things like that, but the youngsters, they don't want to play like we played from the soul and express themselves. It's something that they have in mind. They figure, well, you old man, how can you teach me something?
You know, I heard Count Basie say one time that you had sat in with his section. I don't know when this was, but, and he said all the musicians looked around and said, my God, you know, where has this sound been all this time? Because you were blowing down the whole trumpet section.
Yeah, I was in Miami, Florida. He was playing raw garden blues, you know, and I'm playing that powerful lead.
Well,
see, I got 4 men up there.
Might wake some of these guys up.
Well, they don't want to play it like that. They want to play what they see and what they used to call them pea shooter mouthpieces and squeeze them notes out. Well, everybody happy. I just don't bother with those things. I mean, I enjoy sitting in with a pop band, any kind of band.
Mm-hmm.
As long as they can pick up my lead, don't make no difference.
Well, what kind of... horn and mouthpiece to you, just for the record, so...
Well, we always had a mouthpiece that that you could relax, you know, like in the brass band. Old man Moret used to have the Excelsior brass band. He was 70-some years old at the time. And he could always hit that high note and stop that big band when it was time to. And we never did believe in mouthpieces that would pinch your lips.
No, you didn't use shallow ones either.
No, you didn't have to do because it's just like a tight shoe, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You can get on a pair of tight shoes tonight, and then tomorrow your foot's so swole up you can't put them on the next day.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we don't do that. We relax.
Well, now, do you normally play on the
normally play the red? Amateur.
Do you play on the red part of your lip?
No, I play on all the lips I can find. And leave it like that, see, because my mouthpiece is a pretty big one.
Yeah.
And now I can relax. I don't have to worry about, I got to squeeze this one and do that. No.
So you got your full tone all the way up and down.
That's right. You don't have to stay up there all night long. No, you know what I mean? But these cats, in the early days, doing all that fantastic horn blowing they used to do, and whistling and thing, and then they go to make a record, and they can't make a record. The chops are all swollen and beat and everything else.
Now, Jabbo Smith had a pretty good range, but he didn't have that sound up there.
Well, it's something that he didn't have to keep playing.
Yeah.
You know, and he wouldn't take his teeth. All that's important.
Yeah. Well, when you originally started playing the trumpet, did you stick with the embouchure you began with, or did you change it?
No, don't change embouchures.
Mm-hmm.
No, you don't do that because... I don't know. The only man that played on the side that played good to me was Celestine.
Mm-hmm.
He played right in the side of his mouth.
Like Bill Davidson did?
Is that the way he blows?
Bill Davidson way off to one side? Like
I don't see how they can stand it.
Mm-hmm.
After the embouchure belongs in the middle.
Remember Chief Moore, the way he played his drum?
Chief Moore? With a tooth out, he could play that all. Yeah, I thought he was great, too. But I don't do that. I just play the horn, and you know what I mean, and don't bug myself with it. If I feel that I can't play no more, I'll just tell Joe Glazer, well, this is it. Drop everything, you know. And whatever outcome is, that's it. I mean,
yeah.
I ain't gonna jive myself.
Well, you could...
No.
You apparently got the right the right chops because
I don't want to prove the impossible.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going into 62. Herb Cain thinks that I don't know my age, but I mean from the little boy I was born on the 4th of July, and that's all you go by, you know. But I mean, it's a laugh. It's a good deal. I mean, you know, could be younger from the way he's put it. But I ain't particular about that, you know. I'm happy, and I don't want to ruin my life. You know, a person don't live but so many years, and very few make 100.
That's right.
So I'd like to have the rest of these not worrying about little simple things.
Yeah. Let me ask you another thing. Don Redman once said that everybody was... very impressed. Musicians were impressed by Bessie Smith in the 20s. They learned from Bessie.
Well, that's because at that time, she was the most perfect blues singer, and we had none yet to out-sing what she did.
No, I agree with that.
With the feeling and things, so that's respect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They might have some blues singers now coming up, who knows, but they don't sing blues much now. They want to sing Pagliacci and Swing Time.
Twist.
And the Twist, and which is all great.
Yeah.
But they ain't got, Billy Holiday with that My Man Don't Love Me blues about the next thing.
That's right down there, isn't
that's
it?
That's right. But like I say, everybody's happy.
Yeah. Well, I wondered if, when Don was saying that, if some of the Eastern musicians weren't they had a fault, I would say, from having listened to some of them. They didn't understand the blues and the extending the phrase to the full value the way Bessie would, the way you did.
No, you know what? It all happens when you take every musician that came from different places into New York. Mm-hmm. They wasn't there 2 weeks before they got on the executive side and, office, and they want to be
business.
Yeah, business, and it's something changes in them at all times, and that's something I never did want to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I never did want to sit up in the office and book this and book that. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what happened to music. And that's where all the... Now, there's Dizzy and Charlie Parker. There was admittance, just having a lot of fun blowing.
Mm-hmm.
And then here come my agent. This is a style.
Yeah.
And then all the youngsters come up, dig that.
Yeah.
Well, as you go along, it changes. Rock and roll and all that stuff come from different things like that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But... people will go out to a fad at one time.
Yeah.
Probably they can't come back. But they'll try it one time. So when they look around, there are a couple more millionaires, and that's it.
But I tell you, there's something lasting, something that's still important in your style that I think was in Bessie's. And I think that maybe some of the youngsters are just starting to think about this again. And that's this... singing on the horn, or playing like a singer would,
give it the same
full value to each note.
And, that's it. That's all you need in music. And I always felt that way, even when I was singing a little quartet. And even if I put the horn down, there'll always be some spot where I can jive up a little. Living stuff and mm-hmm. or just play be around music,
yeah.
You know, because I'll never change.
Mm-hmm. Did you get that approach from having been a singer
or? In a quartet? When I was a little kid, I sang voice.
You think that affected the way you played too?
Well, I figured it's singing and playing is the same. Every note's got to have its value, mm-hmm. and. Listening to people like Joe Oliver and them brass bands playing those funeral marches,
mm-hmm.
Just like a symphony mm-hmm. would be in that Dulcie era when they get soft and
yeah.
La 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 yeah yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's
jazz.
Yeah.
See, that's the way I look at it. Anything you can express to the public is jazz, but they get too far out and then lose themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't bother about that. I don't worry about what the other fellas doing.
There's a lot of feeling of opera singing, of good
most of it,
singing.
Most of it in the olden days, the old French opera and things like mm-hmm. that. Most of that music comes from the opera.
Yeah, Bechet had a lot of it in him. That's
a voice in it I used to make all the time.
Yeah?
Yeah. It all comes. But it'll never die out, I don't care. Anytime you make it and hit it on the nose, somebody's going to enjoy it.
That's basic music, I
think. That's your basic place.
Yeah.
He expresses them for big band, expressed himself.
Yeah.
And you got to have a big band nowadays at all times, like the Tommy Dorsey band, the Glenn Miller band. They had tones.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they were so great. They phrased.
Yes.
Didn't that stand on the head?
Yeah.
They played good.
Yeah, Dorsey had that sound, singing.
And your first chairman, and your trombone, first trombone, your first
mm-hmm.
sax,
mm-hmm.
and Dorsey had that sound, and he wouldn't put a man in his band unless he had a tone.
Yeah.
Like Bunny Berrigan.
Bunny, yeah, he had a beautiful.
There you go.
Well, I think there's some.
You're listening to an interview with Louis Armstrong, which I conducted back in 1962. Louis mentioned Bessie Smith. I mentioned Bessie Smith, and I'd like you to hear Bessie in 1925 with Louis accompanying. I think Fred Longshaw was on the keyboard here, but it's really kind of a duet almost with Bessie and Louis, and both of them singing. Well, we were talking about it, so here it is.
Youngsters that got out of that, they didn't last long to begin with, and they didn't know how to take care of the amateurs and thing, and forcing them to know some thing. When you look around, they're through and within a year. So
yeah.
They don't play 49 years, 50 years. See what I mean?
That's true.
So it would be wonderful for music to just come down and be good.
Yeah.
That's all necessary.
So you once said about a trumpet player that he sounded like he had a mouthful of hot potatoes.
Yeah. And when you go to Decca to make a record, there's a woman there with her arms, with her head red back, her arms stretched out, hollering, "Where's the melody?"
Yeah.
Where's that melody? And the melody would count. Sure. We'd play our simplest number down there. In the Fairmount, and the people enjoy it because they know what you're playing. Well, just play it good, that's all necessary.
Well, you used to do some things on records that would get pretty far away from the regular melody, but to be your own melody.
Yeah, but it wouldn't be too far that they didn't know what I was playing.
Mm-hmm.
The lead, like Connie Chapsua and...
Yeah.
And, a Weather Boyd rag and whatever it is, but I'd always hit some lead in there.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was in there, I mean, it was in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
See, now, them other new styles come from the player got the lead in their mind, but they're playing obligatos to it.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
They play obligato to themselves sometimes.
Yeah. But the people don't know that, you know? That's why I said, You can't control it unless somebody just come up, the youngsters coming up and allow it, a little kid, 13 years old, in somewhere in Oregon, he came up and played with us. He played Muskrat Ramble and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Starting with some barbecue. Beautiful. And all he did was play that lead and tore up the house. And a little kid, about 5 years old, grabbed my horn one night in my dressing room and played Star Spangled Banner. Oh, can you see?
Yeah.
Them notes coming out just as broad.
Do you remember hearing Johnny Glazell? Remember him?
Well, I don't know him personally. He must have been in one of the bands. Huh?
He was with Bob Wilbur. And when he was about 15, he was playing some of your old solos, note for note, but very well, you know. He's a very good musician. He's playing with the symphony orchestras now. All-around man, you know.
Good.
But here he was 15, and he had the feeling for it.
Bob Wilbur, I remember when he started out, too.
Yeah.
Well, what, he playing clarinet now?
He's playing clarinet, yeah. He played with Eddie Cannon's group for a long time.
That's right.
You, didn't you once make a statement that you'd never forgotten any of the music you'd played?
I'll never forget, but when you got babies that never heard them, you know, sometime we run back there and... It's kind of hard to carry all that lead all through one of them things, and then unless we're rehearsing. See, now I got all of my records that I ever made on tape. So anything that we want to play to the extent, I just get me a ranger to take it off. Maybe Billy Kyle will take it off.
Mm-hmm.
We can do that, you know.
Yeah.
But just to run on there and say, well, let's play, what is that thing? I can't. I'm not rough or something like that, you know.
Yeah.
They're not hard numbers.
No, but you have to be ready.
Or let them know, you know.
Do you remember?
Now with Jack T. Gordon, I could do that.
You could, huh?
Jack T. Gordon, about it.
Yeah.
No, you know, the cats from that area.
Well, they remembered the records, too.
No problem.
You remember a record of the Sweethearts on Parade?
Yeah, remember that?
About 1929 or 30.
Well, I made a couple of them. I made one with the big band, with Lou Russell.
The early
one. But the first one you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I played that once for Dizzy, you know.
Yeah.
And he hadn't heard it. Mm. And he said, my, I said, that's where Roy got all that stuff.
Well, that's his man, Roy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you played things in there that Roy was doing later on, you know.
Yeah.
The double time thing.
In the 30s, Roy was blowing, man. Down that place in Chicago there. What is that place there down on State Street there? Roy and Zudy had a band.
He had a truck. Parham was with him for a while.
Yeah. But you know, Muggsy can bring back memory. I went over to hear him the other night, and he can bring back some wonderful memories.
He still talks about Joe Oliver.
Yeah, and I do too.
Sure.
I thought he was a great man.
Tell me, did Joe ever get recorded up to the level he could play? It didn't seem
to be. In the later years, he comes to fading out with different musicians, youngsters that didn't pick up on him and broke his heart. Wind up an old man before you know it.
He didn't.
Should have caught him in the days when he was playing at the Pekin and
there.
Early days.
Well, that's what
1922, 25.
That's what Muggsy said, that just before he started making records, he was really playing at his very best.
Yeah. He didn't get a chance to express himself, you know. Mm-hmm.
Would you like to play the old New Orleans style that way again?
Well, everything I play is the old New Orleans style, probably.
I mean, with that kind of a sound and group?
Well, yeah, I could do it. Mm-hmm. Probably I will.
Straight bleed and so forth?
Give me about a year out and I can pick out all them tunes from the tapes and things. Probably mm-hmm. I come back, that's all I'll be playing, you know? Them old, good old, good old, way back.
Would you like
I know it's a feel for that, you know.
Sure. Would you like to work with a big band again?
Well, it don't make no difference what band. I'm going to play my solos in there. Mm-hmm. Most of I do with a big band is direct.
Mm-hmm. And do you have a preference? If you could have it any way you wanted it?
Well, if I'd ever give a big band again, I'd just pull out the Dixieland group that plays it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then let them play big numbers and things.
Mm-hmm.
See, it wouldn't be no problem. It's nothing a problem, I mean, because you just can do so much.
I always liked that background for you, you know, that the Louis Russell band had.
Yeah.
Charlie Holmes and the saxes and all that.
Too. That's right. You don't play no softer, no louder. It's all the same.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Did you make any changes in your approach when you switched from cornet to trumpet?
Well, no different. I would have had the cornet yet if it don't be that symphony orchestra I was playing with. See, in 1925, Moise Tate. Mm-hmm. He asked me to get a trumpet because the cornet looked too small mm-hmm. with the other trumpet, you see.
Yeah. Did you have a chance to try a trumpet before that time? Just to try one out?
Well, I just come up from New Orleans, and we didn't see many trumpets down there. I got to Chicago when I got the trumpet.
You didn't play with Fletcher?
Oh, with Fletcher? Well, by the time I got to Fletcher, let me see, I went to Fletcher before Tate, so yeah. I was playing cornet.
All cornet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the same. It's just what you get used to, you know.
Joe Smith played cornet, too, didn't he?
Well, for a while, and then he got a trumpet.
Did he?
Yeah, like Bobby Hackett. One minute he got a trumpet, mm-hmm. one minute he got a cornet, you know.
Yeah. Well, Bobby he says he likes to use the small horn for little rooms, and then the trumpet for his
studio. Yeah, but I don't like this mixing. Like when he asked me to play one time at his place, I said, well, I'm playing trumpet now, and you playing cornet. So, in the olden days, they just pick up a man horn and play, but you don't just grab a man mouthpiece
mm-hmm.
and play his horn. I couldn't put my mouthpiece on his cornet.
Yeah, yeah.
So I didn't play it.
What kind of trumpet did you get when you started using the trumpet?
Oh, I had a Martin.
Martin.
King.
Did you play the J cornet for a while?
Harry B. J was the cornet I was playing.
It was?
In Chicago with the little knob where you can adjust them out, adjust the mouthpiece, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It was making them in Chicago at the time.
They
were good. They were pretty long. They looked like a trumpet.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, longest cornet I ever was.
What about that slide cornet? Did you ever play
that? Yeah, I used to play that.
Did you?
Yeah.
Can you play them in tune, all right?
Oh, yeah, just like a trombone. Mm-hmm. The position's a little shorter.
They're so close together.
Close together, yeah. And a sliding whistle, we used to play that too.
Did you ever sing with Joe's band?
Oh, I don't remember. No, and Fletcher's band either. Fletcher wouldn't let me sing.
I heard a record where you took a break on one of Fletcher's records.
Yeah, remember that's all.
Everybody Loves My Baby or something like that?
That's all. Because if you had singing to do, he'd get a real, we'd call songsters in those days.
Mm-hmm.
He'd give them the music that night before the recording the next morning. And then I'm in the band, all they do is give, but he didn't look at me as a singer, and he wouldn't let me sing. And that was best for me at that time.
Mm-hmm. Well, even at Roseland, did they have singers at Roseland?
Yeah, when we'd make records from the Roseland, and he'd have a singer to come down.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where he should have had me singing.
Sure, that'd be a natural.
Well, some people missed the boat. It's no good.
Did you sing then with, was it Lil that you were working with at Dreamland right after Fletcher?
Not much. Not much.
You didn't really start singing until, about Carol Dickerson?
With Carol Dickerson and my own band when I first made Gut Bucket Blues.
Uh-huh.
And things like that.
Yeah.
Heebie-jeebies and things.
Do you remember how many records Heebie-jeebies sold? Did they ever find out?
No.
It was a pretty big hit.
But it was a big hit at that time. But I didn't write the tune.
Remember the Boswell Sisters record where they took your scat chorus and they sang it in three-part harmony?
And Boyd Atkins wrote that. That was quite a treat, you know.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we didn't bother about it in those days, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Probably been a different thing if I started singing earlier, you know.
Just one other thing I want to ask you before we go, Louis, was you wrote a couple of tunes, or at least one with Jelly Roll Morton, didn't you?
Who wrote a tune with Jelly Roll?
Didn't you? They were...
I don't remember.
I think the credits were on Wild Man, was it?
Well, Wild Man Blues.
Mm-hmm.
We made a record of that.
Wasn't that credited to you and Morton?
Well, I got credit for that on my record.
Mm-hmm.
But I think Melrose was the boss there. He must have bought it from both of us and changed it to Wild Man Blues.
And Chicago Breakdown was...
Yeah, Chicago Breakdown.
General.
That was a character, wasn't he?
Did you know him very well, or did you work
with him? Well, I met him in 1935 after all them years.
Oh, you didn't meet him in Chicago?
That's when I met him in Chicago in 1935.
Oh.
He had been out here, see, and when he left New Orleans, he came this way.
Mm-hmm.
So he stayed out here for years, and then when he come east, I was in Chicago at the time, and I got a chance to meet Jelly Roll.
Hmm.
But I heard a lot about him, and, you know, he was really something.
Quite a character.
Yes, he was. I got all his records of Library of Congress.
Oh, yeah.
He made.
Yeah. Well, those are interesting.
Very good things.
I figure even if he made it up, he's a pretty good storyteller either way, you know.
Well, he was the man to tell it.
Yeah.
And he told it very good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got every one of them. Some days I'll scan through there, and whenever I will put the horn down, I'll do a lot of writing, you know, through tapes and records.
Mm-hmm.
Taste of Wild Man Blues, which Louis recorded in 1927. We're just about out of time. I think we'll have one more segment of that interview from 1962. This has been a celebration, really, of Louis Armstrong, but incidentally, 49 years since the beginning of the Annals of Jazz. And what better way to celebrate than to talk to Louis Armstrong? Okay. With that, I'll say goodnight to you, and later I'll say goodnight to Louis.
what young trumpet players have you heard in the last 2 or 3 years that you like?
Well, I don't know, other than this kid. I still like the ones that's blind, like Bobby and Red Allen and Bugsy. The one that's blind, but there ain't very many youngsters coming up, proving them.
Humphrey Littleton's still blowing well, isn't he?
Well, I thought you meant in this country.
No, well, I was thinking of almost everyone.
Oh, well, Humphrey's, yeah, and they got a lot of nice blowers over there.
Mm-hmm.
Young kids. This Welch, this was his kid's name, Welch. He plays
Alex Welch.
Alex Welch, mm-hmm. Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but these boys over here, when they come up, they don't want to blow jazz.
Yeah.
That's why you can't play some, you know. But all the ones that's still blowing, you know, I like very much.
What recording projects have you got coming up? Anything new coming?
Well, I got an album coming out that we did, my band and Brubeck's band did, of his numbers.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's a beautiful thing. He wrote some things for a show that he wanted me to do with Carmen McRae.
Uh-huh.
So something went wrong with the money or something. So he put it on records, albums. And with the Hendrix, Lambert, and Ross, Carmen McRae and myself. Very good.
Are you singing and playing on it?
Singing and playing, yeah.
Good.
A lot of singing.
Uh-huh. Is this more than one record?
It's got to be 2 albums.
Yeah.
Oh, we did a whole lot of numbers.
Gee, well, that should be exciting. When is that due?
Anytime, though.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Almost anytime.
Anything with your group coming up?
Well, we haven't done anything since then.
Mm-hmm.
In Duke's place. But we travel so much, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe when we get to L.A., we'll probably cook up an album or something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But most of our work is one-nighters, concerts.
Yeah.
So when we leave the Riviera, we'll either go to Australia or London or anywhere.
I hope you get a chance to come back here and rest up again sometime.
Nice. That's what I'm doing, getting that good rest.
It's sure good to see you here.
Yeah.
Louis, thanks so much for your time today. Really enjoyed it very much.
Okay, Pops. Nice.
Good night.
Right.